welcome to TEPSA Explainers. My name is Eleonora Franco, and I am a lecturer and PhD candidate in European Law at Maastricht University. In today's video, I am going to talk about the EU's Recast regulation on the export of dual-use items. In particular, we will look at what this regulation does, how it works, and the role that human rights play within it. There is one main point that I would like you to take away with you after this video. With new technologies have come new threats to human rights. It is of fundamental importance that our technology laws, such as the dual-use items regulation, are structured in such a way that allows them to be flexible and to adapt to geopolitical landscapes. In order to understand the functioning and the importance of the dual-use items regulation, we first need to answer the question, what are dual-use items? But briefly, dual-use items are a variety of different types of goods, technologies, and software that have both military and civilian purposes. Just to give you a few examples, think of CCTV surveillance cameras, which can be used for protection against theft or intruders. Or think of drones, which can be used to take aerial photos. Or again, chlorine, with its many industrial applications. Well, in their military declinations, chlorine can become a chemical weapon. Drones are an espionage tool, and CCTV cameras can become a way to keep tabs on an entire population. Not only are dual-use items a valuable source of income for the EU's economy, which can help build stronger relations with many trade partners, they also play a role in making the EU a stronger global actor in research and development. At the same time, however, their potential for abuse is incredibly high. In the wrong hands, dual-use items can directly contribute to warfare, to the creation of nuclear, chemical, and biological weapons, and they can also easily be repurposed to restrict human rights, democracy, and the rule of law. This threat is more than just a theoretical one. Non-EU authoritarian regimes have been known to use European surveillance technology systems, or artificial intelligence systems, for example, to gather information about anti-government activists, to track movement of journalists and NGOs, and even to implement mass surveillance projects. As a result, the EU has put in place a framework that regulates when and under which conditions dual-use items can be exported or transferred to non-EU countries. The latest version of this framework is the 2021 Recast regulation on dual-use items, which was designed to try and strike a balance between security, trade, and human rights. The Recast works by identifying 10 macro categories of dual-use items, which are listed out in Annex 1. For these items, the regulation requires companies to have a license for exporting outside customs. To ensure that EU legislation remains dynamic and can keep up with technology as technology develops, the regulation also provides that under certain conditions, also items that are not listed in Annex 1 may be subject to further licensing requirements or even a total export ban. This is known as a catch-all clause. So if items are intended for terrorist purposes, to develop weapons, or for military use in a country which is subject to an arms embargo, EU member states must impose export restrictions. They may also impose export restrictions for reasons of public security, including, for example, human rights considerations. The regulation also provides for a specific catch-all clause targeting cyber surveillance items, which are considered particularly sensitive for security reasons. If exporters believe that these items could be used for internal repression or for the commission of serious violations of human rights and international humanitarian law in a certain country, then they may also subject them to an authorization requirement or an export restriction, whether or not they are listed in Annex 1. These catch-all clauses are certainly positive elements in the protection of human rights, especially for what concerns cyber surveillance items. At the same time, there are still some concerns surrounding the system. The regulation does not explain what counts as internal repression or as a serious violation of human rights and international humanitarian law, which may result in an inconsistent interpretation or a narrow definition of these terms at the national level. Additionally, much of the burden of finding out how these items will be used rests on the companies exporting them. These exporters have a due diligence requirement to assess the risks related to their exports. But there is no guarantee that the screening will be 100% effective. The the potential outcome is that exporters may give incomplete or incorrect information to national licensing bodies, mostly inadvertently, resulting in items which should have not been exported ending up in the hands of authoritarian regimes. In practice, we also see that since the imposition of a catch-all clause can lead to reduced legal certainty for businesses, governments tend to use their power to impose a mandatory license requirement for non-listed items with great caution, imposing a high internal threshold for the activation of the clause. Finally, another issue with the system is a different treatment reserved to cyber surveillance items compared to other dual-use items. While cyber surveillance items may be subject to export restrictions based on human rights, for other items, this is not one of the possible or mandatory grounds for restricting exports. Member states have the option to add further restrictions taking into account human rights considerations, but they are certainly not bound to do so. This is not an obligation. The result is that this dilutes the protection system and creates a loophole which non-EU countries could potentially exploit. These limitations bring me to two main recommendations which the EU and national governments should take into account to further strengthen fundamental rights. Firstly, member states should exercise their discretion to impose export restrictions or additional licensing requirements for dual-use items in an expansive manner. Human rights concerns over the rights of privacy, the right to free speech, and freedom of assembly and association should always be considered a sufficient reason to impose export bans, both for cyber surveillance items and for other dual-use items. Evidence from civil society and NGOs in the end country of use should particularly be consulted in assessing whether there is a fundamental rights risk. Secondly, it is important that exporting companies are supported in making due diligence assessments. The regulation already states that the European Commission and the Council will create guidelines for exporters. Ways to ensure that these guidelines are exhaustive could be to formulate them in cooperation with human rights experts, to personalize them to different end-use countries and their geopolitical specificities, and to complement these guidelines with national help desks for exporters. The regulation is still very recent, and it's still not very clear how its application will turn out. What is for sure is that as dual-use items become more technologically advanced, so do the potential consequences of their abuse. Thanks for watching. Make sure to like and follow us for more videos and to stay tuned for the next TEPSA Explainer.